practice you're in Dubai, right? You're in Dubai, Abu Dhabi, where are you?
I'm in Dubai, but it feels like I'm in Abu Dhabi because literally right from across the balcony of my room, I can see the entire downtown, but the smog, or I don't know what it is, yeah? Can you imagine the Burj Al Khalifa can't be seen? It's just like one hazy thing with behind like some bad drawing.
Yeah, that's, yeah, if you're staying in Dubai and you can't see the Khalifa, then the view is not worth it.
I can see Burj Al Arab. I've counted floors. I've been here for 7 days inside one room. So it has 25 floors. I've counted it.
But I thought RCB had money.
They have, bro. They have. That's why they put us up at this state-of-the-art resort.
Okay. So I've heard that you're living in a bio bubble right now, unlike the rest of us who are living in a bubble of delusion. Can you tell us, please tell the audience, what is a bio bubble?
So a bio bubble is something that I haven't ever experienced before. It's very interesting. So we just went on a call about 3 days ago with the folks at BCCI. And everybody through this tech that they've introduced into the tournament. Mm-hmm. So every hotel has been mapped out.
Okay.
I think there's Bluetooth and GPS and Wi-Fi that's connected to one particular device. Mm-hmm. So you can't leave the zones that they've marked.
Okay.
And nobody can enter these zones. So if you leave the zone through your GPS that's on your device that they'll give us, I think tomorrow, it'll send a notification to the team manager and it sends a notification to BCCI, the central team that's there.
Okay.
Saying this person has left the bubble.
Okay.
That's one thing. The other thing is if you come in contact with each other with a gap of less than 2 feet, it'll beep again. So it'll beep for you and for the other person and it'll send it to them again saying these guys are in close contact. So it's fascinating. It's just very fascinating.
So it's basically to make sure that transmission doesn't happen, that nobody gets.
Yeah. Also, they've made rules like we have to wear a mask at all points when we step out of our rooms. The visor, I don't know if you saw the picture of the helmet.
I've seen, yeah.
They said that we can knock that off from tomorrow, but on journeys in buses and flights, again, that thing needs to be worn. But the most fascinating thing that they explained was sitting on a bus. So instead of two people sitting in one seat, because that breaks the 2 meter norm then, right?
Right.
It's zigzag.
Oh, okay.
It's just beautiful, yeah, Dan. I mean, I'm just so glad that I get to experience this being a part of something so huge.
Yeah.
You know, like they're giving us these rings. So the day we landed in Dubai, I think 2 days later, they gave us these rings called Aura rings. First, I thought it was to change RCB's fate, right? Like the last resort is numerology, right? So they gave us these Aura rings and these rings are like health monitors. And then I read up more and I figured that NBA has been using these as well.
Okay.
They're basically tracking sleep. They're tracking, heartbeat, the breathing rhythm. And from whatever I've realized through the last 1 week that I've been here, is it's very important to know your own body and how you feel before you go out there to fight the pandemic and say nothing can happen.
Yeah, because in India, we have this habit of knowing other people's bodies more.
Yeah.
We are more interested.
That is true. We're more interested in other people than ourselves. But
yeah. But tell me, so now you're saying there's a 2 meter distance rule, social distancing rules. That means so when a bowler gets a wicket, he's not supposed to celebrate?
No. No, it's true. It's true.
What?
I in fact wrote that on the question. They had this questionnaire thing, right? So you can ask random questions. So there were two very highly qualified doctors and people from BCCI who were sitting and addressing this thing.
Right.
And one of the questions I asked, which I thought was comedy,
the comedian side of you wakes up and you said,
on the last bench will simply heckle, right? So I just heckled and asked a question saying, so how do fast bowlers celebrate after taking wicket?
Huh.
And they said, you cannot come in contact. So no high fives, no like back slap, or slap because
no contact. Which is so weird, dude. Which is so weird. So if you get a big wicket, you your first instinct will obviously be to celebrate, but then you have to go no, pass matana.
Yeah, it's go that way. I don't know if it's going to be easy to follow for these guys on ground, but I do know that the kind of emphasis that they have on just social distancing, and more importantly, they kind of realize that this is one of the biggest events that is happening, at least in the Indian context, after about 6 months. Sports has this insane power to transcend across boundaries and unite. So I think they want them to not just be good ambassadors of the game, but also just ambassadors of
social distancing.
Social distancing and so on and so forth, and fighting this pandemic. Yeah.
But I mean, if there was one sport that embodies social distancing, I think it would be cricket.
Everyone's really far away, right?
Yeah, there's literally no reason to touch anybody other than celebrating a wicket.
Or of course, if you're Shree Sant and Harbhajan Singh, then it's different.
Yeah, then thoda pyar ka chaata. but the Champions League and Europa League recently concluded. They weren't maintaining social distancing. I mean, they were celebrating goals. They were hugging each other. So does the BCCI know something that UEFA does not?
No. So Dan, if I have to read it, I think what they're trying to do is also go by the mass that's going to be consuming the game. What you and I probably feel, I had the same question, right? And in fact, somebody asked this question saying, hey, if we're doing all this, then what's the point of the bio bubble?
Yeah, exactly. That's another thing. A bio bubble supposedly ensures that everybody within the bubble are not infected. So by that logic, everybody should be able to just interact. Likewise, I mean, all of us at home are technically in a bio bubble as long as we don't venture outside. So while you're within the confines of your own apartment, then you can touch another person if
you have somebody in the apartment.
If you have someone to touch, basically, if you have someone to touch, you can touch them.
So it's fascinating, right? So somebody actually asked this question that you asked. I think what they're also playing on is the fact that this is not just about cricket. It's also about informing and educating a broader mass that's watching.
Yeah.
The responsibility is that much more.
I mean, I think if that is the intention.
Totally, I can read it.
I think if that is the intention, I think it's pretty big on BCCI's part to kind of drive home that idea that it's not safe to just, carry on like everything's back to normal, which is what's happening in most parts of the country right now, because the government's not talking about COVID right now. Everyone's pretending like it doesn't exist, and we're all seeing this happen around us. So that's a really good thing.
For me, the indicator of that was when I looked up my investments app. So the first time I saw it, I went like this, like awkwardly turned to the side and saw, because everything was red, and I fucking died. I was like, shit, what about all my money now? Then when I saw it all coming back to green, I was like, what is happening? Like, there's one picture on one end and then there's something else happening at another. What a paradox. I mean, like, it's so confusing. Yeah.
I mean, I spoke to my guy as well also about my investments. He said, just wait for 3 years. Don't touch anything for 3 years.
Don't touch anything.
Golden rule. Don't touch anything for 3 years, he said, and your money will be fine.
Don't touch anything.
But that's cool, man. I'm really happy that the IPL is actually happening, because, and I think this year will have the most viewership, I feel, the IPL has ever had, because like you said, this is the first major event coming out of India since COVID hit. And initially, even when I was watching the Champions League and Europa League, I was like, okay, will this be fun? There are no fans in the stadium, but I think they did a cool thing. I don't know if you saw these games, the broadcast, they kind of added the filler audience, fan noise. So you couldn't tell that there were no people in the audience unless they cut to the stands. So I wonder if they're going to do that with
IPL
as well. Yeah.
Because I actually saw it in the Caribbean Premier League.
Mm-hmm.
So right now, I was watching a couple of games the other day, and I heard this flute thing go. Like, I don't know what they call it, but like...
Okay. Right.
ये स्टेडियम में बजा कौन रहा है, मतलब एक आदमी है उधर जो बजा रहा है.
Okay, there is one guy. Okay.
No,
okay.
I thought. Then I very innocently asked someone in the team, actually. I said, so who is this guy? And then they explained it to me and said, it's just a feed that they've taken for the broadcast. It's not somebody who's really there playing that shit.
Yeah. He's not. I think that's what these guys will also do. It kind of adds to the viewing experience. If you can hear the fans cheering. I think it's easier with cricket, because football, you have so many varied reactions. I mean, I assume they had like a bank of different reactions, and with cricket, you know, you'll just have the buzzing sound, and then when if somebody hits a 6-4 or a wicket, the reaction is largely the same.
The same, yeah.
Yeah, that's the same. And I think maybe they could just cut to Ravi Shastri pouring himself a peg every time Virat hits a 6. I don't know.
You know, I'll tell you, it's very cool you say that. I actually had an incredible experience when I was at the World Cup in England, last year.
Last year, yeah.
It was pretty cool, actually, because, you know, it's amazing you say that when there's a wicket or there's a 4 or a 6, the reaction is broadly the same. It depends on which side
you're
on. Because
the IPL, it's a mixed bag, because
it's
IPL, got our guys everywhere. Yeah,
international cricket, man. If Virat, or I'm saying that's now, but I'm saying back in the day, if Sachin got out, can you imagine like silence,
pin drop silence? Yeah,
just silence. Everybody would be so stunned. It's amazing, right? I mean, the more and more I look at sports, just as from the outside, and I've never been this cricket expert or the sports expert, but I just look at it as a fan going, fuck, it's beautiful. Like,
it's the energy, right?
Yeah. Like, I'll give you an example, Dan. This is probably the coolest thing that I experienced. When we landed in Dubai, it was about 40 degrees, 42 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
And I was talking to Parthiv and Yuzi on the flight.
Yeah.
Generally checking how's the game been, and I've been very curious about this one thing, which is the collective level of the game going to drop? Because you're as good as me. I've not batted, you've not bowled, right? So I'm correct. As patchy as you.
Yeah.
So Yuzi was telling me how he's gone back to the nets over the last over the last 3 weeks.
Right.
And it was the first time he picked up the ball, and I asked him what was it like to throw like bowl for the first time. He said it felt surreal. It just felt fucking new. He's like, you know, I have such a good throwing arm from the boundary line.
Mm-hmm.
Now when I throw the ball, I don't know if I can reach it to the wicket from the boundary. He's like, I don't know if my arm will support that. And then Parthiv said something really cool to me. He said, you know, in a situation like this, what happens is two things can happen. One is you can go into a shell.
Yeah.
And be like, fuck, I need my technique. And the other thing is to say, I'm going to go by instinct. And he's like, if somebody goes down the instinct path, it's like, you can either go really up, like you can just like spiral into like a different zone, or you can just go all the way down.
So yeah.
It's going to be very interesting. I'm really looking forward to this tournament.
But I think like most sports, even especially with cricket, and whether you're a bowler or a batsman, it's about rhythm, isn't it? I mean, I don't know if you played cricket when we were younger. I did as well. I was in the school team. And it was always about rhythm. The more you bowl, the better you were. And if you stop doing that, then it feels weird. It's the same with comedy also. I don't know if you felt this when this happened initially in the first 2 months. I didn't do any shows, and I just had all this pent up energy. So every time I would talk to my friends or hang out with them, I was always roasting them because I had no outlet
for
the comedy. And then when I started doing Zoom shows, I kind of felt that I had that same feeling, man, this feels really weird. And also when we do Zoom shows now, obviously you're watching everybody on a screen. So it does feel slightly surreal. And I think that's what's going to happen with cricket as well, when they can't celebrate the wickets and stuff like that. Everybody has to still keep their distance, because cricket is an emotional sport.
Sport is emotional, right?
But with cricket and India, when you combine these two factors, it has a religious fervor when, you know, so when somebody hits a 6 or a 4, there's a wicket, you want to touch someone. You kind of feel that connection.
Man, I did this show once on Crick Buzz. And it was called Stranger 11, and we basically asked people questions about cricket. It was the common man having an opinion.
Yeah.
And I happened to meet this doctor from Bombay. I don't know if you know him, called Shyam Vallabhji. Have you heard of him?
No, I know Shyam Bhatt.
Shyam Bhatt, that both of us can talk about a little later in this podcast about the importance of Shyam Bhatt in everyone's
The importance day. Of Shyam Bhatt, yeah.
Yeah. So Shyam Vallabhji told me about, so the episode is about Dhoni, and I was very curious about how he does it, right? Like, how does somebody go in, 6 balls, 20 runs, you know this guy is there, you know he's going to hit it. It doesn't matter who, you just know he's going to do it. So I asked him how, and he said there's something called muscle memory.
Right.
Like every action in our body is so deeply like...
It's like programmed, yeah.
Programmed, yeah. It's amazing we say we're not robots, but I think at some level...
We are programmed, yeah. Our core value system, it's all programming basically.
Yeah.
And it keeps evolving over a period of time. And similarly, your physical movements are also muscle memory. Yeah. Go on.
I'm actually very excited about going back on stage whenever this happens.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I think the first thing I'm going to do is, obviously, hopefully there's a vaccine out. I think I'm just going to go hug everybody in the audience.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's going to be new. I can't wait. I can't wait to be on stage.
I can't wait to hear that applause when they, you know, when you're called out. You're on stage, and then you walk on stage, and that feel that especially when it's a crowd that knows you, and they're just like, you know, okay, that's going to feel amazing.
Yeah.
So you mentioned earlier that you weren't connected to cricket. You were an actor, comedian, RJ. Pick a lane, yeah. Danish, first of all, these people with so much talent really piss me off, you know. just pick one thing and do that one thing instead of making all of us feel like we're
useless. I've actually left that for my 40s. Until I hit 40, I want to dabble through everything. Single thing. Because I feel like only when you've experienced everything do you really have an opinion about
something.
You know, about what you like.
But I also feel that we are part of the generation that needs to do many things.
I
feel that doing just one thing doesn't cut it. Like, so for me initially also, when I started doing podcasts 3 years ago, it was just a means to an end to get people to come watch stand up.
Yeah.
But now I'm so into this that I've, in my head, these are two different things that I do.
Correct.
That feed each other, of course. But now being a good podcaster for me is as important as being a good comedian. So I think, and these kind of opportunities weren't there in our parents' time. They didn't have the luxury of choosing what to do. You did what came your way and then you stuck with it. Like, I know, like for my... from that generation, I know people who've started and ended their careers at the same company. At the same organization. Yeah. And that's mental. I'm just
I just spoke to somebody now, yesterday, who's been working with the Arabian Radio Network for 12 years. His name is Rohit. And I didn't know how to react. I was like 12 years in the same company.
Yeah.
But by the way, I should tell you this. I completed 8 years at Fever. 8 years at Fever.
Eight is good. The longest I've worked for any organization is 3 years. And then, obviously, now stand up. So it's been 9 years with comedy. And this is the longest I've been committed to anyone.
But you're not, right? You're not technically committed. You're committed to the profession.
I'm committed to the art form. Yes. Yeah. Not to an organization, not to anybody's HR policy. So I am the CEO. I am my HR department. I am the marketing head. I am everything, which makes it kind of stressful in a unique way.
It's amazing you didn't say accounts. I don't get accounts. I fucking don't understand accounts.
I manage my accounts. I mean, of course, the heavy stuff, I've got my CA doing it, but I keep a track of what's happening.
Will you do?
Yeah, I like numbers that way. And so I think it comes with you liking that aspect of the job also. So I like, so I'm very immersed in taxation and my income, cash inflows, outflows, all of that. So I have like this whole macro view of what's happening financially with my career kind of. I mean, I think it also, I think it's an important discipline. It kind of helps me, but like I said, we're also part of a generation where if you are not good at something, you can always find someone who's good at it and pay them to do it. So
Yeah. That's, you should want to take interest, you know.
It helps. It definitely helps.
You need to sit down and learn it. And in fact, accounts is something that I've just started to learn. Because I just realized it's too long that I've not been doing it. And my mom's very good at it. I'm so glad my mom's so good at it, because she just handles it, takes it all and says, here it is.
Yeah, that's another life skill I learned. Like, have people that have certain kinds of skills, very key skills in your circle, you know. So people are good with tax, people who are good with health, fitness, people who know cops, people who know lawyers,
politicians
and thugs. You need to have a mix of all of these. You never know what you will need when, you know, so.
You asked me about kind of what profession do I want to choose and how cricket happened.
Yeah, tell me how you went from radio to cricket, where you
were. It's a very interesting story, you know. I was doing, I went to watch an improv show.
Okay.
Called The Improv, where Kenny and all these guys were performing. Right. And I felt, hey, I can be on stage. I can be on the stage as well. Mm. And then I made it to the team. And then we started doing these improv shows. And my first ever improv show, this guy called Nikhil was at the show. And he's the business head of RCB.
Okay.
And Nikhil looked at me and said, hey, man, you do improv pretty well. I've heard your prank calls.
Mm.
Can we create something cool together? I said, sure. What do you want to do? He said, just come over to my office, we'll meet. For 1 year, there was radio silence. I didn't hear anything.
Okay.
Then he called me in. I went into his office and we sat down with him showing me clips of Sacha Baron Cohen doing Ali G with NBA players.
Oh, he did. Oh, yeah. I saw that, yeah.
Yeah. And he showed it to me and said, this is what I want you to do with cricket and cricketers. I said, so how does this work? And he said, go on, figure it out and come back. So that's when Mr. Nags happened. And then it was just instinct taking over. It was just instinct. Like, I had no idea from the word go till date. I don't know what my next 10 videos are going to be. I'm just sitting down saying, okay, whatever event happens, we'll come up with something. We'll figure something out. So that's how cricket happened. And then that's been a staple for the last 6 years. And this character became so big through RCB and video, I had to make a film out of it. So then I made a film that got me another film.
Okay.
That got me a series, which I've produced with Applause now.
Right.
So that's coming out sometime soon. So it's just been things just piecing
together. One thing has led to another.
The other. Yeah.
That's really cool, man. And I think it's a good, it's a good kind of inspiration for a lot of young people watching, because let me tell you, there is a young generation of people who are confused as hell, which is a good thing. I think with our generation, we weren't confused enough. If that
because
makes
our
sense.
Options also were a little...
Well, cool, huh? Yeah.
People like us, I think the real champions in stories like, you know, you or me or I'm saying so many other people who are in this profession, I think the real champions are our parents, because they trusted just our instinct, because what was their yardstick to say my son is a good comedian or my son
nothing
is a good
at all
actor.
Yeah.
Nothing, right? They just said, you want to do this? Okay, we'll let you do it. Also, you need to know that they come from a different generation.
Yeah.
Now the kids have access to all of us. So they have, like, I mean, if I ask you, I didn't watch too much stand-up, bro. I'm being very honest. Neither did I.
My only reference to stand-up was Russell Peters, 2008.
Yeah, same. And how did you spark this off then? Like, I mean, how did you...
Just like your story, mine was also a sheer accident that led to other things. So I was doing my MBA in Pune. And while I was studying there, I had this whole plan of, you know, okay, I wanted to get into sports marketing, and I had a whole plan out, blueprint. Like, I'm going to work in the IPL.
I think you would have been good at sports marketing.
Yeah, and I'd met with Mumbai Indians team, the management team, when I was doing my MBA, and I was like, okay, I can see myself occupying a space here. During an internship, I met them, and I always thought that's where I was going to go. And then during a college event, one of my friends was organizing it, said, hey, do you want to perform and do something?
Yeah.
And I've always been on stage since I was six. So I've done most of the other stuff, like, you know, being in a band and dancing and singing and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So I said, let me try something new. Let me try stand up. And I don't know what made me say that. Let me try stand up. Because like you said, I had no major frame of reference. I had maybe watched Russell Peters, Chris Rock, just a few names at that time. I wasn't as immersed into stand-up as I am right now. So I thought, okay, let me give it a shot. I tried it out. And my first ever stand-up performance was 15 minutes. It went better than I expected. And I still remember before I got on stage, that was the most nervous I've ever been. And I said, if I can do this, I can do anything. I got up on stage. And these are 400 people who know you. These are not random strangers.
Hey, but then you guys didn't have this whole canvas and all back then. So how did you actually make it a profession? Because
before that,
in Bangalore, we had Allianz and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
Where we could go like do improv, whatever.
Yeah, yeah. So this was 2011. January 27, 2011 was the first time I ever tried stand-up. This was in college. 400 people from my college. I'm like, okay, if this goes well, it goes well. If it doesn't, people are going to remember me as the guy who tanked trying to tell jokes. Thankfully, it went well. And I thought I was done. I thought that this is it. I'm going to do this again. I thought this is like a bucket list thing. I'll tell my kids or grandkids one day, this one time when I was really young, I tried it. Huh?
Yeah.
And I had no clue that simultaneously in Bombay, the scene was just starting to mushroom. The Comedy Store had just opened in 2009 or 10, around that time.
Oh.
So I moved to Bombay and I'm like, okay, there's a comedy club here. And then they had open mic. So I tried out their open mic first. And then Veer had organized a bunch of open mics as well. Then I did one of those. And that's when I got hooked. And I was like, I still remember this precise moment. It was at an open mic in Malad at a pub. It's packed, about 100, 150 people. People are standing and I had to do 5 minutes. And I did 5 minutes. And that it was the first time I experienced that wholesome, that big laugh in your face. And I was just like, wow, this is cool. Like total strangers are laughing at me.
Wow.
And this feels amazing. And I'm like, wait, I want to do this for the rest of my life. I don't know how I'm going to do it because there was no money in comedy at that time. So I was like, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I will figure a way out.
And I also think you're one of those rare first few people to do a lot of social commentary. I remember I've been a fan of yours, I think, since you started putting out those clips on YouTube. And I've said this to you, I mean, almost every time I meet you, I'm like, hey, I'm a fan. I remember watching, I used to love the social commentary that you would do. Why don't you do it anymore? I still do it. I don't see you putting out those YouTube clips.
I do it now in a different way. So even the podcast, the first 20 episodes, the first 20 episodes were in a similar space. So I still talk about stuff that's happening in the country. It's more political now and slightly less other stuff. But that time it was different because what I used to do is all those videos that you've seen of mine about 4 or 5 years ago, they were all written, workshopped, performed and recorded within a span of a week.
Yeah.
Which is actually not how you're supposed to do stand-up. With stand-up, you're supposed to take your time and, you know, flesh out your jokes, keep doing them again and again till they get really good. But I didn't have the luxury of time because A, I had to drop content and B, this was topical comedy. So it had to go out on time. So as soon as something was in the news, I had a week to turn it around into stand up.
Yeah.
Whereas, so thankfully there, the club circuit kind of helped. I was doing that many shows. Today, the circuit is a little different. We have shows only on the weekends. I'm doing only solo shows. So I don't have the luxury to, you know, perform these bits so many times and then get it out there. So the way I perform stand-up has now changed, which means I can't do those clips the same way. But I think I bring that voice with the podcast. So I do, you know, comment on the stuff that's happening in the country, whether it's politics and sometimes other stuff, but I still do it, but I think I do it now slightly differently. So, like I was saying, it started off from that open mic and one thing led to another and today, you know, here we are. And I think in both our cases, what really worked for us is we took a chance on something.
Yeah.
And it, hopefully it will pay off. I always like to say that it will pay off. I don't count anything that's happening. It's not paid off yet. I will always think of myself as a struggling comedian.
It's very important. Insecurity keeps us going every single morning. We're disciplined to say, shit, I'm going to wake up. I'll give you an example, right? Tomorrow in the morning, I have an interview with Mike Hessen and Simon Katic tomorrow in the morning.
Nice.
I don't know what time the interview is at, but I know I'm going to go to bed early today because if they give me a 10-minute heads up, I don't want to wake up sleepy and then run in. I just want to go be on.
Yeah.
I think that's what these opportunities and that's what, being committed and really passionate is about. 90% is intuition. 10% is going with the flow because we knew we had to do this.
Yeah.
But we didn't know where we'll go or where we are going to go.
Like for me, working backwards also always helped. I knew that I wasn't cut out to work in an organization. I couldn't fit into that framework. So I knew, okay, this is not for me. It needs to be something else.
You've never done a corporate job.
I did a corporate job for three years.
Yeah, that's what you said, right?
Yeah.
That helped.
It definitely helps. I think doing things that you eventually realize are not for you is as important as finding out what you are meant to do.
Correct.
So for me, kind of working the corporate life, and then realizing, okay, this is not for me. Then I thought, okay, maybe if I do an MBA, that will give me more direction. Then I did the MBA thinking that I'm going to go in a certain direction. And then turns out I went in a completely opposite direction. So for me, I think, bowing down to the unpredictability and then saying yes to things I would have said no to many years ago, kind of helped me get here.
Yeah.
That's intuition. Yeah. And but I like what you're doing with RCB. I think there's no other IPL team that's doing what RCB is doing with you, right?
No. These guys are the first ones to bring about a character. And imagine it exploded so much the first year.
Yeah.
That literally, this is the coolest thing that happened with me, right? We were on a flight from, I think it was from Bombay to Ranchi. Hmm. And we were playing this quarterfinal against CSK there. For some reason, the match happened in Ranchi.
Okay.
And we were on this charter flight and the trophy was with us.
Okay.
And they let Mr. Nag shoot with the trophy.
Right.
So it was a picture of me and the IPL trophy. And I'm the only RCB guy to have my hands on the trophy so far. How cool is that?
That's crazy, dude. I think next they're going to just ask you to open the batting. Finished. I think that's the only way.
I hope it doesn't come down to that because I'm very scared. I did this piece once when we were in Bombay. And funnily, last week, I was talking to my mom about it and we were laughing. I was doing this piece in Bombay at Star Sports Studio. Mm. And Brett Lee and Shoaib Akhtar were there. And these are guys who have retired now and they become commentators/analysts.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And in that little corridor in the Star office, both of them are whatever, Mr. Nags, we'll bowl to you.
Hmm.
And they literally stood there and did this. And the bastard ball was so fast. It fucking hit my ribs, man. I had marks.
Huh.
So I can only imagine what they would have been like at their... Can you imagine
at their peak.
Prime? At their
peak? Yeah.
Oof.
It's a crazy level of skill required to excel at this sport, dude. Because you have to be good at so many things. You can't just be...
I don't even know if they see the ball coming. I don't even think they see the ball.
Do you think sometimes they just close their eyes and swing? They're like, lag gaya.
I think so, no? Because, it's very interesting. I've actually had this chat with so many people who are like the batsmen, right? I've had a chat with them. And more often than not, it comes down to the fact that they kind of know what the bowler is going to do. It's about your reading of the game that helps you play the game. It's not just I'm going to stand here at the bat, this guy will bowl and I'll see he'll hit. How the fuck do you see something that's coming at 140
plus kilometers per hour, I think, it's reading the game, reading the bowler, reading the field. You know, based on what... based on what the field is, you kind of know where he's going to pitch the ball and stuff like that. I mean, of course, there's a science to it, dude. There's a science to everything. Like, even you and I know with comedy also, there's a science with how we do what we do. It's not, we may look goofy, we may look like, oh, it's all in the moment and it's amazing, but there is, even if it's in the moment, there's a science behind it. So similarly with sport, but yeah, I agree with what you say, man, to play that kind of pace and bounce and to do well.
And you know, the thing of science that you say is fascinating, because my therapist told me this. She said, there's a science to living life.
Hmm.
I was like, wow, is that so? I thought, you know, life and science are different things. She's like, no, it's the same thing. There is science to living life. You can't just go about rampantly doing whatever the fuck you want.
Yeah.
You know, you got to know what affects your body. And what affects your mind? You've got to put checks and balances. You need to know what to say, when to say, when to move away. There is dynamics involved, right?
True.
How close, how far?
Yeah.
Incredible.
I believe in this thing called lifestyle design. Where,
what's that?
So it's basically you having visualizing what you want your life to look like.
Yeah,
and it's not a rigid framework, but it gives you enough to kind of give you direction. Okay, I need to go here. So when then, every time you have to make a decision, every time you need to do something, you then see, does this fit into my lifestyle design?
Yeah.
So for example, my lifestyle design includes where I want to live, how much I want to travel, how many international holidays I want to take a year.
Yeah.
You know, what are the things I need to have that level of comfort or to be able to support myself and take care of my family. Then when I have that framework with me, then I work backwards. So for me, then every time, whether it's a business decision or whether it's a personal decision, I see how it fits into my lifestyle design. And then it's easy for me to make a decision. Otherwise, then you just have a blank slate, which is scary for me.
Yeah.
Like, I don't like planning too much of my life, but I kind of like to know which direction I'm heading. And I think that's important, because then I don't know if I want to take a chance on living a life that's too chaotic. And then suddenly
chaos is not good
in certain areas, because suddenly you go from, okay, at 31, you're really killing it. At 39, you're in a place where you're broke. Your car has been seized and you know, your wife has left you. So you don't want to, and I've seen that happen with people. So two things that I do diligently is, one, you know, pay attention to my lifestyle design, and two, observe what mistakes people ahead of me are making.
Right.
So that kind of, so whenever I meet people that are ahead of me in their journey, and I'm like, okay, I want this. I like what he's doing. That's a good thing. So let's see if I can get something similar. But more importantly, I don't want that to happen.
That's beautiful.
So like,
it's amazing how you say this, because I think it also just brings about the importance of having good people around you.
It's very important. And that's something you realize in your 30s. I don't know if it's the same with you, but I realized that in my 30s that it is so important. And it's about quality and not quantity.
Quantity.
It is quality. Like those 6-7 people at best, you know, that. And for me, do you believe in energy? Like, people have energies?
I mean, yeah, I do. Sometimes it's just off. Sometimes there's something not working. You get into the room.
That's the energy. So I think, I feel that artists especially are very sensitive to energies. Like, you walk into certain rooms, it's like, okay, I'm not feeling it. But you walk into certain rooms, you're like, fuck, this place is buzzing. People have energies as well. So, and what you said is right. It's very important, especially for people like us who are always creating. We are constantly creating. We are not following.
You can't have the negative shit around you.
You can't have negative shit around you. Yeah. So negative people have to go. Negative thoughts have to go. So there is science. Yeah. So what your therapist said is true. And I think science is such an abyss in terms of how much information in both in terms of practicality and theory that it holds. That then you have to choose what you want to use. Which part of that science? And I think what your therapist said was right. Yeah, there is a lot of science in the way we live, how things shape up, how societies evolve. So yeah, your therapist is very smart.
Well, I needed her, because I could see it all going downhill. I could see that spiral going down. And I was like, shit, man, what is going on? I mean, I feel like a hamster in a wheel.
Yeah, we spoke about this when I think you and I did a show together. This was
in Delhi.
Yes, it was. The weather was amazing.
You know, yeah, the weather was lovely. And I think that was the first time I really saw the human side of you, Dan. Because you know, otherwise I know you're a great, you know, I've always been a fan, I've admired what you do. And I'm like, hey, because I don't do stand up, right? So for me, anybody who does stand up, I'm like, wow, how did they do that? I mean, how do they write this stuff and do it? How? And then I meet you and then we start talking about stuff that's human. Like what connected us was the fact that I looked at you, I said, bro, you're looking damn fit. And you said, yeah, man, I'm doing it for the mind. Even you're looking fit. I said, fuck, you're doing it for the mind. And that's how we connected about mental health and how we're both going through our own little thing. And Ciprolex, are you still taking Ciprolex?
No. I got off medication a long time ago. So for me now, you still are? I always believe that if the medication is prescribed, if the medication works for you, you should take it.
100%.
I have no qualms in popping a pill if I need one.
You know,
I'm not one of those people who are like, don't put pills in your body. Just shut up. It is made. If I need it, I will take it.
Take it. Yeah. No, because Dan, you won't believe it. The number of people I meet who are taking like psychiatric medicines. I'm like, dude, we should all get together.
Yeah.
And do a little party where we're just throwing pills into each other's mouth. Calm us down. You know, like I'm not talking about drugs. I'm talking about prescribed shit. Right?
Yeah, just powdering it and then just snorting it, rolling up a 2,000 rupee note and snorting it.
Yeah. I'm like, let's do this. But it's right. You're right. You're right when you say that if it works for you, do it. It's very important to do it.
Yeah. Because for me, what's working right now is through therapy, I've learned to kind of identify what my triggers are, how to manage the triggers whenever they, you know, arise or show up. And then all the other lifestyle changes that kind of help manage, you know, the chemical balance in the brain and the body. So for me, working out is a big, big driver.
Yeah, likewise.
So I hit it like 4 times a week without fail.
I do it every day, man, for like half an hour, 45 minutes. Then I also have this habit around about eating kachara. I end up eating kachara here and there. I just eat something.
A little bit is fine, I think. As long as you kind of burn the calories that
I just work out. I sweat it out and I'm done. Yeah. I don't care whether there's six pack, no six pack. Fuck that. I just want
one pack. If I have one pack also, it's enough. And if that pack works well, I'm happy. Yeah.
I'm happy. Yeah.
But I wanted to kind of, and I was thinking about this before we started recording also, when I recall that the last time we hung out in Delhi, is that there's something about being an artist that a lot of people do not talk about. I think, like you said, we already know artists from what we see them do, you know, whether it's a video, it's a movie, whatever it is, you see a certain part of them. Yeah. And then you have this influx of, you know, attention that they get. Some of the attention is good, some of the attention not so good. And you are constantly absorbing people's ideas and opinions about you as an artist. And I think the one thing that people don't talk about when it comes to artists is the emotional and mental cost of being one.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
You know,
and I think that there is a very heavy price.
Yeah.
That artists pay. And I think that's how you and I connected also. We kind of understood that while we are doing different things in a similar space, we also understand the cost of that existence.
You know, fortunately for me, I have this line in my head. I have a very clear line in my head that there are two facets to me. One is the personality and the other is the person. Whatever people consume of what I'm doing is personality. Whatever I'm with my friends and family is person. I don't have to be funny. I don't have to do a joke. I can just sit down in the corner. I can be stupid. Nobody cares.
Right.
But what the audience feeds off is personality. And I've realized that the audience will feed it positive and negative.
True.
And it shouldn't get bigger than you and you shouldn't let it go out of your hand.
Yeah.
I have it right there on a leash. I know whether good comes or bad comes. I know it's coming to the work and this personality.
Yeah.
They have no idea what I'm like in my personal life otherwise.
Yeah.
And I never step into this territory because it doesn't fucking matter. Like whether somebody sits down and appreciates, doesn't appreciate, says good, says bad, I'm still going to do what I do because this is all I know how to do.
True.
Right? True. I'm just going to continue doing that. But the person is very isolated from this. Yeah. I try and keep myself as real as possible because the moment I let this personality feed into the person, people around me will start seeing a difference.
Yeah. And I think that's a very good point. I think that's a line that a lot of artists struggle with.
Very important.
Where you separate the two, you know, and then I think so what's happening now is a lot of artists are kind of getting affected by everything that's happening outside of their work because they're not able to separate that line. For me, I had to learn the hard way initially. You know, of course, we all get the good comments. We have the fans that love us, yeah, no matter what. But then you also have to deal with these random pappos from Kanpur or wherever trying to tell you how you should be doing, yeah, comedy.
Yeah.
And like, I remember a few days back, I read a comment on this last episode of the podcast because I spoke about Sushant Singh Rajput. And my God, that topic has become such a Voldemort of discussions, but so obviously,
yeah, I just feel very bad. Yeah. It's a very young life,
yeah,
that shouldn't have gone the way he went. He's very talented, and I really hope that if there is wrong, I hope there's justice that's served,
yeah,
and more importantly, I hope his soul rests in peace, because Dan, it just breaks my heart. It does,
you know. And so yeah, I mean, and I had done an entire episode on Sushant literally a few days after it happened, that the following episode was all about him. Then the circus started, and now nobody knows what's happening, who did what, when it happened, stuff like that. So obviously, my opinion was slightly different from the opinion of the
unpopular
masses.
Unpopular opinion, yeah.
Unpopular opinion. So there was somebody who said, "Oh, you are inhuman because you have this opinion. You are inhuman." Then there was another video a few days back where somebody said he didn't like the video because it was a political video about the BJP and stuff. And then he was just like, "You deserve nothing," and nothing in caps.
Okay.
And I was just like, dude, and I get what you're saying when you talk about that, you have to separate the line and differentiate between person and personality. And I was just like, man, if this was me, say 3 years ago, I would have lost my shit. But now I am able to kind of disconnect and go, okay, this is a response to the work and not the person.
Yeah. He doesn't know you, right?
He doesn't know you.
So he can form an opinion no matter what he or she wants to form an opinion about.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people look at me and go, "Hey, don't abuse or don't have a pun, sexual puns in your videos. Kids are watching." And I'm like, but I'm sate. I'm not saint.
Yeah.
I'm not a moral online lesson.
Moral science teacher.
I've learned my own moral things kept happening around me. Can I tell you about the fact that I grew up watching my parents fight? Does that make you feel that does now does that mean I can sit down and brood about my childhood that was a disaster? If I tell you that, does that give me brownie points in front of you? No, it doesn't, right? Yeah. At the end of the day, that happened. I'm here. Yeah. I had a lot of things there, and I've become this person. Your child will also become whatever he has to become eventually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
True.
But Dan, I think, you know, when you speak about this thing about this person saying you're not human and you're inhuman and so on and so forth. Dude, people will do people things. You're right. You can't engage with everyone. You just have to put that full stop and say, fuck off, I'm done.
Yeah.
Now, when I see something like that, I just block them. I'm like, it doesn't matter. I'm like, your ego is not interested in what I do. So why?
As well, not give you access. Yeah. Why give you that?
I don't want access to you. You don't want access to me. Best block. Yeah. Get done with it. As simple as that.
True, but I still want to get at what that emotional cost is. What that mental cost is. So I'm trying to get people to understand. What it takes. Okay. So tell me, let me rephrase my question. Okay. So what does it take for you emotionally and mentally to be the guy you are on Instagram, with RCB, on stage, in your movies? What is the emotional and mental cost? Like, what does it take for you to be who you are?
You know, I think the biggest emotional cost for me is to disengage from my personal self. Like being Danish, it's about disengaging from this and just becoming someone else. Literally becoming something else. And even if something happens to Danish, these people will not let it impact Danish.
Yeah.
Because I'm purely somebody else for that moment. I'm not myself for that moment.
Right.
It takes me to a space which is higher, because I think when I look at my own self, I'm just like any other human being, right? I feel sad, I feel happy, I feel, you know, angry. But when it comes into being in this state, you're at such a heightened emotion of being goofy or funny or doing stupid things that you're not here. But when you come back to your reality, I think then it's about making peace with what, you know, that state of mind you was. I mean, it sounds very confusing, but
I get it. I mean, it's about basically just separating yourself from who you need to be on stage. What is required to deliver the goods?
Absolutely.
Whereas when, if you're in a traditional job, maybe, you know, you can still be yourself 100% at the office, and you can still be yourself. You're not two different people largely, you know.
I'm sure even they have to do that, right? Because when you go even to an office or a meeting or whatever, at the end of the day, you're with a bunch of strangers who aren't going to take your shit. Like, you know, my mother will always say this. She'll be like, oh, you go outside and argue with people, we'll see. I can't. That's true. I know.
I've argued.
Huh?
I've argued with people outside also. We can't argue with people in public.
You can't randomly go and just, like, see, at home, you can still
be like, see, at its very core, there's a certain decorum that you will maintain that's different with the family and different with, but largely you are still the same person. Like, I wouldn't say, I mean, from my experience, when I was working in a corporate car and I had the 9-to-5, I wasn't too different.
I was,
I mean, like, I don't remember being too different. I was pretty much the same guy. But I find that here, being when you're doing this, that separation of self is more.
Yeah. Maybe. I mean, I was very different. I'll be honest. In an office job, I was very different. I was very different. Almost like this, But also because, see, Dan, the thing is, you did like a proper job. You did like a proper MBA sort of business job.
Yeah.
I was a radio jockey. So I still had to.
Okay. As a radio jockey, I mean, that's pretty similar to
what we're doing now.
What you're doing now. So that's
frame of reference is very little there. So
Mine was poles apart. Cool. So that's your emotional cost and the mental cost of doing this.
Mental cost comes after you.
So heavy, no? Yeah.
People will say anything and everything. They'll tag you. They'll be like, you know, they'll abuse your mother. They'll abuse this, that. And that's what baffles me. Because imagine, okay, if I had to go to some random guy's profile and write Bhosadi ke there or Madar Chod there and come back. How would we react? Like, I want to know.
If somebody, you know, you make this presentation, this important presentation at the office, and you take it to your office, and your boss is there, and your team is there, and your boss looks at the presentation and says, "Ye kya chutiya? You don't deserve anything. You deserve nothing." I mean, it's just.
I don't know. Yeah. I read it and I've stopped getting impacted by this stuff now. I've really stopped getting impacted. I'm very like in a headspace. I remember the time I met you in Delhi to now, Dan. I've really evolved to a point where today I'm like, fuck it, dude. Like, nothing's permanent. At the end of the day, nothing's permanent. Even this, what I do today, I know maybe tomorrow, if it's all taken away from me, I'm okay to go. I'm fine.
Yeah.
I'm fine. And it's not because I've reached this, you know, sage level. All I know is I'm so confident that I built this from the scratch. One thing I know. I can build again. Take away everything and I'll build it again. That's fine. I'll fucking wait tables in a different country and I'll build it upwards again. I know how to do it.
Yeah.
But I've stopped getting impacted like emotionally because of some random fucker's comment. I'm like, Papa, he's just written something and gone. He must be angry. I don't know what frame of mind he watched the video in. I don't know. Like, one guy yesterday wrote to me on Facebook saying, you are a dumb fucker or something like that. First, his English is wrong. Now,
does this happen to you where if somebody like sends you a hate message and you're just looking at the grammar and going, but spelling to theek se karo na.
Very important, right? He's written, you are dumb fucker. Now, also, his name was Manjunath. And in Nagraj, I have a character called Manjunath. So I can't be angry with a Manjunath, no matter what he says to me. So I just wrote back saying, I love you, Manjunath.
I think that's a cool thing to do. I think every time you get hate as an artist, just reply back saying, I love you, and whatever that person's name is. They just go like, I love you, that's it.
Yeah.
And And I would just love to see the expression on their faces when they read that. They just, because they're looking for confrontation. I always believe a lot of hate and vitriol online, not just towards artists, but to anybody in general. Even people are fighting against each other. I think it's a lot of projection. It's a lot of projection of, like, for example, when that guy said, you know, you deserve nothing. It kind of, I feel like it was more of him projecting something that is happened to him, where he's been told that he deserves nothing or he feels like he deserves nothing. So they kind of like I've noticed this, unhappy people want to see more unhappy people.
I spoke to Akash Banerjee once.
Why does his name sound familiar?
He's the Deshbhakt, no, on Twitter.
Okay. Okay.
Great guy. You should actually get him on this podcast. He's very good.
Okay.
Akash said something beautiful to me. He said, when you're driving a car, if somebody points a gun at you or hurls an abuse at you when you're driving your car, what are you going to do? Or they're following you. What do you do? You drive off, no?
Yeah.
You're not
going to hang around. Yeah. You're not going to be a hero. Yeah.
And in the, like, why do you want to do that on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram? Keep driving. You have a job. Just keep driving, no?
Yeah.
You can't stop and fight with everybody along the way, because then you're just stalling yourself from getting there. And there are going to be people who will come every now and then to find a problem with, no matter what you do.
True.
Like, I'll give an example. On one end, I have like the former chief minister of Jammu and Kashmir retweeting my stuff. I have MPs. I have so on, so forth, across party lines, people, strata, gender, sitting and sharing my stuff, appreciating what I do. Then there is a tweet that I read which says, I don't know why people find him funny. Now, can I discount what 100,000 people have written to what one person has written? One person can't be bigger than 100,000 people, right? That means they're doing something right.
Yeah, of course, of course.
If it doesn't apply to that person, okay, good for you.
But again, there's science there. There's science in that reaction where you'll read 100 compliments and then that one bad remark will set you off.
It sticks
out. And there's a, I don't know if you've heard this song, Everybody, I think Sunscreen. I think Everybody Loves Sunscreen, or by Baz Luhrmann. There's a line in that song. It's a beautiful song. There's a line in the song that says, remember the compliments, forget the insults. And if you succeed, tell me how.
Okay.
So it's pretty, like, that's the kind of, that line has kind of really stuck with me.
Lovely. Yeah.
So now whenever I do get the odd insult, I'm just like, yeah, but let me try and remember the compliments.
Very important. Very important. Yeah. I mean, bro, I tell you, Dan, if you ever get a chance in life, and I pray you do get this chance, right? I pray you do. And I pray that every artist in this country gets that chance. Actually, every human being, right? Release one film in the theater.
Okay.
A film that you're a part of as a lead or a director or a cinematographer or anything, basically with a rank, right? In the film. I really hope you can release one film, because it just changes your life like fucking that. Okay. And I'll tell you why. Because when my film released, I was 29, 29. When my first film released, it was a big release in Karnataka. And that was just one state, mind you. And then it went to Amazon Prime.
Right.
It fucking changed everything for me, man. Because the day it released, I got brickbats, I got bouquets, I had fucking samajh mein nahi aaya to fucking go back to doing radio, to some saying you're a great actor. Random things coming my way. And I did not have a frame of reference in the home to call and say, what do I do? How do I respond? So I called my school principal. I said, sir, this is what I'm going through. I don't know how to respond. And he said, who are you? He asked me this question. He asked, who are you? I said, so I'm Danish. He said, no. Who are you? I said, I'm just a human being who's doing my job and who likes it. He said, you're a human being. What you need to understand is, today God faces brickbats.
Oh, yeah.
Who the fuck are you? I was like, yeah, nobody. Correct. So he said, don't take yourself too seriously then. Don't take the bouquets to your head. Don't take the brickbats to your heart. Let them say what they want to say. You've made it for them to have an opinion.
True.
just be glad that people have gone out to see it. Full stop.
Best. I think that's
insane advice. That changed my life. Yeah. That evening changed my life.
Yeah. Because I think what I wanted to draw out from this conversation is that while there is a certain emotional and mental cost that comes to any profession that you're in, you know, whether you're a doctor or lawyer, whatever it is, there is an emotional and mental cost. But I think with us, we have to deal with that emotional and mental cost in public.
Every day.
Every
time you put something out.
Yeah, every time you put something out. So I think what you've said kind of like, you know, gives a lot of perspective for any artists watching this, you know, because five people watch this podcast for sure.
The five artists, usually you'll only watch only like Bombay people will only watch what Bombay people are doing. They don't step out of the circle. It's very few.
That's a separate episode. The whole community. That's a separate episode. But I think, yeah, what you've said some really pertinent stuff, and I hope that anybody watching this can, you know, take a leaf out of what you said and apply it. Like I've certainly, like, I mean, I've had my own way of looking at the same thing, but I think what you've said has added that extra layer of perspective. And I think it's really important, while you may form your own perspectives in life that help you go forward, it's important to, you know, embrace the other ones that also kind of say, hey, I can use this. I don't know if this happens to you, but when I meet interesting people and like talking to them and they say stuff, I'm like, hey, I like this. I want to keep this with me. And I'm going to use this going forward. So yeah, I think what you've said is an extra tool that I think an artist can have in their kitty.
It's important, bro. At the end of the day, I think a situation like this, people keep saying, fuck, this pandemic has ruined me. It's not your pandemic. It's a global pandemic.
It's a global pandemic. So yeah, so
get out of your own head.
Get out of your own head. Don't take life too seriously. Don't take the brickbats to your heart, and don't hold on to the bookcase too tight either. But I want to circle back and, you know, close it on more high energy, vibe. You're at the IPL, dude. You're at IPL 2020. I think the most unique version of the IPL we are going to see.
Yeah.
Tell me, do you know who's going to win?
I can hope.
Isn't it pre-decided like pro wrestling? Like there's a Vince, isn't there a Vince McMahon?
No, that's not true. Because I'll tell you, 6 years, I've seen the passion of these teams, man. I've worked with a team. It's incredible how much, and they're very fucking good. Huh? I've seen, I'll tell you, there was, I think, two IPLs ago. I'll tell you a very fascinating story of me being in a post-match dinner.
Okay.
And the team was having a very rough patch. I mean, it's not new. It's RCB, right?
So basically, it was Tuesday.
So Tuesday, whatever game that it was. And AB was sitting down and getting dinner. And he was talking to the team. And he said, what happened today is, you know, just insane. And he said, I know someone's going to get hurt. Someone's going to get hurt. And he was talking about the teams that they were going to play, right?
Right.
Like, I know someone's going to get hurt and they're going to get smacked really bad. Someone. It's going to happen soon. And fucking the next match, Voila, he went and hammered the fucking team that they were playing against. Yeah. Like, they're so good. Like, you just hang around and you realize these guys have so much to learn from them.
So, how much time do you spend with them when you...
All the time, Dan.
All the time. So, all who's like your closest buddy from RCB?
Uzi, easy, very accessible.
How's Virat?
Very sweet. Very sweet. He in fact texted me. Imagine, I'm not kidding you. Like, I'm not kidding. He texted me this IPL and said, bro, I can't wait for this to end and we should all meet.
Nice.
He's sweet. He's very nice. Again, people look at him on the field, like doing, and all that.
That's what
Like
we spoke earlier, you know, about the personality and the person. I think all of us have seen Virat the personality. Yeah, you've seen Virat the person. Dan, so tell me what that's like.
Dan, he's lovely, Dan. He's just like you and I. And he said this to me. He said, I'm we're the same age.
Yeah, we are all the same age. He's like slightly younger, I think. Yeah, a couple of years younger.
Yeah, he's I think.
Dude, I'm 36. If Virat's the same age as me, then he'll be calling for his retirement also. Okay, so
Virat and I are the same age, 32. We're the same age. Yeah. There's obviously going to be a difference in terms of how you look at life and I look at life. You have 4 years more than me.
Yeah.
Like,
still in the same
bracket, but
I'm never going to go Danish Hamare Zamane mein.
Like, no, of course not. But I'm saying that your experiences are a lot more, right? You had 4 years more of experiences compared to
perhaps, him. Yeah.
Yeah. He's just like us. He's just a regular guy. He's just
a regular 32-year-old.
Yeah. Dan, come on. You and I need to say this. I don't know why we've not spoken about this. Arnab Goswami, dude. I saw a clip you put up on Instagram. Yeah. I've been in the studio. You've been in the studio. Is he the same person when the camera goes off?
Once the camera goes off, he's a normal person.
He's a fucking sweet guy. He's so sweet.
He is. And people find that so hard to believe. I'm like, dude, he's nothing like this in real life.
Thank you.
He's not.
I remember him doing this debate about some protest that was happening, something, and I happened to be in Bombay, so he got me into the studio. I swear it. You remember there was a time when he used to get people like us in the middle of this political madness. Yeah. What do you have to say? And then we'll say something stupid and then he'll go back. Yes! And then he'll go back again. Remember that? Now he stopped doing that. Yeah. Now he doesn't need us because he's doing the jokes and everything he's already doing.
Yeah.
So I remember this time when I was sitting with him in the studio, he was going off at this politician like, almost like, you know, the truth, you fucking have no idea what you're doing, blah, blah, blah. And the camera goes off and he looks at me and like laughs and says, so how long are you here in Bombay for and what plans for dinner? I'm like, fuck.
Yeah.
You split personality. Such a sweet guy.
But that's so funny, you know, like, because everyone is a certain way when the world is watching and then the world thinks that, yeah, this is who they are all the time. This is the same with Virat also. Not. Virat obviously earlier was a little aggressive, and I've noticed this as well. He's toned down a lot now, and he's grown into this whole
All space. Of us are 24 months. All of us had just, what do you do with that much popularity, money?
It must be crazy. That's exactly what I'm saying. Like you, and especially after Sachin retired, Virat filled those shoes. I feel, at least personally, it's my opinion. You know, I don't know. I might probably get hate from Sachin fans, but I think Virat filled those shoes.
I mean, Sachin for me and Virat.
Yeah, he's such you. I don't want to compare the two, but for me, I feel that I miss Sachin slightly less. Yeah, I miss Sachin slightly less because we have Virat.
Yeah, I mean, he's our Sachin Tendulkar today.
He's our Sachin, yeah.
He's our Sachin Tendulkar today.
But, so Virat is Virat's very nice, you're saying.
He's a nice guy. Like, you can talk to him about stuff like content, you can talk to him about, I don't know, like fucking ducks sitting in a park. There is a obviously, there is a little bit of a one line is there. You can't cross.
Yeah, there is a
There is a line. So you like generally like, you know, so slept well. You like
casual conversation. you can't go, how's Anushka? Everything going well?
it took me 3 years to reach that point.
Where you could go, how's Anushka?
That was a how's family.
You can't. I think another 3 years before you can start taking their names and stuff.
But that's in my head, you know. That's in my head.
I'm sure.
Maybe not in his head because he's pointed it out sometimes. Why are you doing this? Like, just be
normal. And I think that's what a lot of famous people crave when they meet other people. They're like, just treat me like a normal person. I think when you keep treating them like a fan, like as you keep behaving as a fan, then they're like, yeah, man, I can't do this. Please now leave me alone.
Dan, beat this, Dan. His brother, Vikas Bhaiya, when we were in England, we were in Manchester, India versus Pakistan. That's where it happened, right? India, Pakistan, Manchester. Like, so sweet. They organized tickets for me and the team to go watch the match, They reached out to me and said, do you have tickets? Why? Because they know me. I travel with this team for 6 years. I've been around. Like, they're good people. The point is, we don't see. We just see him going like, and all that stuff.
No, and I think also, I think largely, I think the fans today have a very high opinion of Virat. In his initial days, of course, man, he was 21. He was being 21. But now I think he's very respected in the cricketing fraternity. I think what happens with a lot of people now when they think of Virat, or if they ever think, or if they ever bump into him, if you ever have the opportunity of bumping into him, it's more about awe. You're like, oh my God, I'm...
He's got that aura.
I saw him once at the airport. I was taking a flight out of the country, and that time the team, I was also flying out somewhere the same night. And here's the best part: the entire team started walking one by one. Bindas by themselves, cool. No one's doing anything. Just walking up, and then two cops, Virat, two more cops behind him, and then he's walking, and he was just being very calm. Cool, just waved out to people and stuff. So yeah,
you know, that way another like really nice player that I've met in this whole RCB setup is not player but as a human being, AB de Villiers. What a fascinating experience I had. My first IPL, we reached Mohali, and I managed to lock myself out of the room. And you know, you have these fucking stupid key cards that get off when you keep them with the phone.
Yeah,
yeah, I hate those. Okay, so I locked myself out. I come running down and I'm running back into the lift after taking a key. And I see this man standing there with a huge pile of papers.
Right.
And I'm like, hey, what are these papers? And he's like, I'm studying property law. And that's AB de Villiers. And I was like, you know, in India, parents tell children you study and don't play cricket. But it's amazing how you're playing cricket and you're studying. And he's like, yeah. I mean... you have so much time in between games.
Right.
Even though it's a quick turnaround, right? They're playing every second day, third day, whatever. You have so much time that what do you do? I'd rather just study something and take my mind off the game.
Right.
I'm fresh when I go there.
Right.
That's cool, right?
Very cool, dude.
He's a lovely human being. Lovely.
I've heard AB. What about Chris? Have you ever hung out with Chris?
Morris?
Gail.
Oh, Chris.
When he used to be.
I've hung out with Chris. Chris is your quintessential 36, 37 year old.
Party animal?
One, but again, yeah, he's not that type who's like, you know, jaisa dikhta hai waisa ki hamesha party kar raha hai, hamesha daru ke saath, aisa he's walking. He's not that guy. He's got his daughter, his family,
right,
with them. When he comes out, you know, he's lovely because he spends a lot of time. I'll be honest, my interactions with Chris have been very minimal. I've not seen him spend time with me.
Right.
At the same time, I've not seen him spend too much time with only the A grade cricketers.
Yeah.
No, he's usually down to the 19 year olds and the 20 year olds and the 18 year olds, the younger kids. Because it takes one generation to bridge that gap and bring them up to speed here. Because, for example, Sarfraz, you know, Sarfraz Khan at one point was like, fucking, he's hitting the ball at the back. He's hitting it in the front. You remember that period? Just exploded. I think in my opinion, a massive credit should go to Chris for being so gentle with him, you know, almost like a parent.
Right.
I don't know, like, it's like, I don't know if parent is the right word, but...
Mentor? You know,
sorry?
Mentor,
yeah.
Right.
Because you just wipe out that boundary and say, come, be with me. And I've seen him do that a lot with the younger kids. I've seen him do that a lot with the younger kids. And I think he's just warm that way. Just warm.
Nice. And who's the funniest guy in RCB?
Dude, hands down, Yuzi, man.
Yuzi
has to be the funniest because Yuzi is just a funny guy. He has a lot of... Yuzi is a heckler. He's the guy who sat with us on the last bench.
Right.
He's that guy.
Nice.
And then Virat can't be funny because he's Virat, right? He's Virat. Like, how are you? So...
Yeah.
And even if he says something, you have to be like... right? Well, usually you'll just say the most stupid things and
get away with it.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll wrap up with one last question. What's the fondest memory you have of being a part of RCB all these years? You have one? Like, yeah. I hate sounding like one of those cliched journalists, but I feel like I want to just...
I do. I think my fondest memory would actually be the greatest heartbreak that I've experienced.
Okay.
And that's what heartbreak feels like. This was 3 years ago when we made it to the finals of IPL.
Did you?
16. Yeah, we did. Yeah.
3 years ago? It was 4 years ago. I'm not sure. Yeah. Okay. Whenever you were, you guys were.
I'll tell you, this was the IPL where Virat was in red hot form. He hit like some 300-400. Remember those?
Right. IPL? Yeah.
Fucking ape shit. He was just hitting everything all over.
Yeah.
We reached the finals and I was so excited because I was called by Star the previous day saying, keep yourself free for the next day because there's going to be a championship bus.
Okay.
That's going around the city and we want Mr. Nags to be on the bus. The team had told me I was supposed to fly to somewhere. They said, cancel your tickets. You're staying back because you can't not have Nags
on the bus.
On the bus because you'll be the main content driver. Just before the game, I went down to the ballroom in the Ritz-Carlton. Have you stayed at the Ritz in Bangalore?
I think I've visited. I don't remember staying there.
There's a ballroom below there.
Yeah.
I went to minus one. I saw the ballroom. They had done this beautiful setup. It was the Roman theme.
Okay.
Because, you know, glory and champion and so on and so forth. Lovely lighting around and this and that. And then match day, the game happens and they lose.
Right.
And I came back and I went down into that room and I realized that there was going to be no championship bus. I was not going to be on that bus. I was going to be no content driver. Let alone no bus driver. I went down to the ballroom and I saw these, just, you know, the event collateral.
Right.
There. And lights. Dimly lit room. And I could just stand there. And you know what happens is, they book tickets, they block tickets and book tickets.
Right.
So if a team loses, then if the foreign players need to leave, they pre-booked and they're sent.
You're right.
So the match got over at 11 and there are international flights out of Bangalore at about 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock
right.
in the morning. And I could see like AB walked into the hotel saying, we're sorry, guys.
Oh,
man, that was just heartbreaking. And then they left and I could see that they were leaving and it was just down to the event team and, you know, the management, the 4 or 5 people. And just the digital crew and, you know, that feeling of everybody packing their bags and just going.
Yeah.
I fucking have like my, I'm like, I feel like crying even saying this to you, but it's not my, you know, it's not my fondest memory, but it's a memory that will stay with me forever. Like it's the greatest heartbreak I've experienced.
Okay. So cool. So then I hope that this year,
like, I have tears in my eyes. Just saying the story, I have tears in my eyes. Yeah. No, because, Dan, I mean, you know, this team, and I, when my film released, and I'm saying this to you, you know, I'm saying this to you, and I have no shame in admitting it. When my film released, when my second film released, when my series was commissioned, I have sent thank you messages to Virat on all three occasions. I've sent thank you messages to the coaches. I've sent thank you messages to the management because I was nobody, man. I would have been doing radio, I would have been doing improv, but this team has given me a space in this massive world of entertainment and cricket.
Right.
And I feel very deeply. I mean, the tears in my eyes should explain it, I guess.
Yeah. Thank God those tears are in a bio bubble.
Yeah.
But yeah, and I think, and I, it's really nice to kind of see such a human connection with the team.
Yeah.
I mean, we as fans watch the sport. Of course, it's on an emotional level too, but in a different way. There's a distance with those emotions. And I think it's nice to see this side of the team and, you know, the highs and the lows and what the each personality is like. And maybe if you're an RCB fan, I hope if you're watching this, it makes you love RCB even more.
No, I love and, the team, man.
Yeah.
I love this team.
And
I can promise you my children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, yeah. Fuckers better be RCB.
As soon as the kid is born, RCB jersey, where now?
Straight up. Yeah.
So, yeah, I was hoping RCB has a killer tournament 2020. I hope they win it this time. And when they win, I hope they remember not to touch each other.
But they can touch the trophy, I hope. That's important.
Yeah, I'm sure they will. But anyways, thank you so much for joining me, Danish. It was a pleasure. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to be with me. For those of you watching this, I hope you had a great time. That's a wrap from us. Don't forget to like.
Is this live?
No, it's recorded.
Achha.
When they're watching, I have to pretend like I'm talking to them in the moment.
Oh, so
okay. Like, oh, he's speaking to me.
sorry. Okay, take two.
Take two. Yeah, that's a wrap, guys. For those of you watching this, thank you so much for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Don't forget to hit like, share, and hit subscribe. Do comment as well. Tell us what you thought about this discussion. What are your favorite memories of RCB, I'll see you again with another episode. I do this every week, dude. This is the 26th week straight. It's mad. Wow.
You should get Akash Banerjee next. I really want to watch that episode.
I'll get him on.
I'm sending you the number right now.
Send me Virat's number also, no? Okay. And so I'll see you guys again next week, Danish. I'll see you when you're back. Let's hang out.
I'd love to when I'm in Bombay.
Once you're out of your bubble, you come into my bubble and where touching is allowed. And we'll share stories. You can tell me what's happening with what happened with RCB that you can't mention online. And I'll tell you from my life as well. All right. Take care, brother. Lovely hanging out with you.
Thank you.
For the rest of you, thank you so much for tuning in. I'll see you again soon. Take care. Goodbye.